will follow wherever you lead me. I will follow.
I will follow. I will follow. I will follow. I will follow you. I will follow. I will follow. I will follow. I will follow you. You open up the doors and the captive is free. You open up my eyes so my eyes can see.
We surrender.
glory. It's your glory. Your glory. It's your glory. Your glory. Thank you. so thirsty for you. Lord, I'm so hungry and desperate for you. Lord, I'm so hungry and thirsty for you. Lord, I'm so hungry and desperate for you. Lord, I'm so hungry and thirsty for you. Lord, I'm so hungry and desperate for you. Lord, I'm so hungry and thirsty for you. Lord, I'm so hungry and desperate for you.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Jesus, holy is the Lord who lives in me. Holy is the Lord who dwells within my soul. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord who's come to make his abode, his dwelling place. I'm the temple of the Lord, a living stone in this place. Gathered around Christ Jesus, built up a sanctuary of God. Jesus. 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 Jesus, Lord, Jesus Christ, Jesus Savior, Jesus, Jesus, Lord, Jesus, my Passover lamb. Jesus Christ, my God, Savior Emmanuel, Oh God, my trust, oh Lord, eternal King. Jesus, Lord Jesus, Jesus. Lord, are yours. All my heart and affections, Lord, are yours. My desire, my dwelling place, my desires, my dwelling. Affections, Lord, are yours. All of my heart and affections, Lord, are yours. My dwelling place, my delight, my delight.
Jesus, ma manda per sé chi è di te. Sere se che tana la la la. Sere di che tana la 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 ma manda per te. Pahata di questo. Manda di questo. Alleluia. Hambra da se chi è di te. Alleluia. Hallelujah. Woo-hoo. Ha-ha. Woo. Jesus. Lord Jesus. Jesus.
Breathe on me, breath of God. Fill me with more of you, that I may love as you love and do as you would do. Breathe on me, breath of God. For I am wholly thine, no riches of earth.
could ever compare to your glory so divine. Breathe on me, breath of God, fill me with more of you, that I may love as you love. Thank you.
tempest of heaven outflow. Let the wind of your spirit, the tempest of heaven outflow. Let the wind of your spirit, the tempest of heaven outflow. Let the wind of your spirit, tempest of heaven outflow. Breathe on me. Breathe on me. Breath of God. Breathe on me. Breathe on.
So in love with Jesus, love the movings of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Lord Jesus, we worship. Lord Jesus, we praise. Holy is the Lord. Holy, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord. Holy, holy is the Lord.
Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let the Lord touch you. Let the glory of God overwhelm you. Let the rivers of God flow through you. Just be filled with the Spirit right now and begin to speak to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Hallelujah. Go ahead, be filled with the Spirit right now. Let the power of God become rushing through your body and your being. Let the overwhelming glory of heaven take you to a place that you cannot go. Hallelujah. 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 Lord Jesus, we worship you. Lord Jesus, we praise your holy name. We thank you for the glory of heaven. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Mama, there it is. Mama, la la manda la kesher mama la leveste David. Go ahead, break through. Go ahead, break through. Go ahead, break past all the stuff. Go ahead, break through. Go ahead, break through. Mama na nambra babashe dena. Go ahead, break through. Go ahead, break past all the stuff. Sabagita la mo, sabaya la mo, jabaya la mo kushi. Si pravaya la mo, si paya pravaya la mo, so paya la kupana. Si paya la 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 mo, pro mama mandera. Si paya la mo, si kaya. Dire na 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 gish.
Thank you. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hura mama mambela mamandus. Hura mama mandela la mangolo si fibra nine. Hura mama mandela la minjera babosus. Kiri mama mandolo si si venen angler. Mamandolo si ki. Hallelujah. Just go ahead, break past whatever's in your way. Go ahead, break past it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, kapata, befrete, fataya, fataya.
Just go ahead and break past whatever's in your way.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, mighty God. Hallelujah.
We found a place of living fully for God.
Yes. Hallelujah.
It's being filled with Him. Hallelujah. It's easy to live fully for God when you're filled with Him. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Well, you can be seated. We'll just get warmed up here a little bit and just break loose into the realms of prayer and praise and rejoicing and letting God, the Holy Ghost, have His will and have His way in your life and our life in this place. See, the church is the fullness of Him that filleth all things, and it's a terrible thing if we're willing to settle for anything less. The church is the fullness of Him that fills all things, and we need to be zealous for His house. Hallelujah. We get the passion God's got about it all. I'm telling you right now, we're going to have His results. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed is the name of the Most High God. Well, you know, I'm just set on, if you've got affliction, if you've got torment, if you've got unforgiveness in your life, if you've got anything less than the full manifestation, the gifts of the Spirit operating your life, that everything changes tonight. And so, you know, there's some people in here that need to hear the message that the Lord laid on my heart tonight. And especially there's some of you that need to hear it. And then everybody else is going to profit from it. And reality of it is everybody needs to hear what God's got to say. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. Just go ahead and release everything over to Him right now. If you're holding anything back from God, don't hold it back. Just go ahead and release it right now. Just release your heart. You know, we pray and cry out to God for the lost, and we should, but there is nothing that's going to impact the lost like you touching heaven. And heaven touching you. Hallelujah. There's nothing going to change the conditions of your family and of your environment, of the place where you live. Listen, I've discovered a realm to live in divine health. And this place of living in divine health is to live in a realm where you don't have any, you don't hold anything against anybody, where you love everybody. You're just so blessed continually. You've only got good things to say, no bad things to say, and you love being in the presence of the Father. You allow the Spirit of the Lord to continually flow through you. You don't let anything hinder that flow. We're here to teach you and to help you with how to have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, how to have a relationship with the Holy Ghost. We're not here to teach you about religion. This is not a religion class. This is not a class in religionity. Hallelujah. This is not religion. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is the great and glorious privilege to be filled with the very life and power of Almighty God. What an honor. Hallelujah. What an honor to come to know Him, to walk in Him, to be able to grow and mature every day in the things that the Spirit of the living God's come to teach us and establish in our life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm excited about this. Praise God. Hallelujah. I want you to see Jesus tonight. I want you to see Him and understand Him for who He is and for His disposition. You know, everything that Jesus said and everything that Jesus did was about the Father. And everything that the Holy Spirit does is really about the Father. Jesus is the one who reveals the Father. Of course, the Holy Spirit has come to reveal Jesus and to make Him known. But if you look through the Word of God, especially in the New Testament, and the things that Jesus had to say, it was all about the Father's will being done, the Father's Word being revealed, the Father's desire being made manifest, His life
being made manifest. And there's something very important for you and I to grab a hold of. And I'm going to, by my everything that is within me, give myself over to the Holy Ghost so that you can hear something that will cause your life to be absolutely changed and absolutely different tonight, that you cannot possibly go on with the attitudes that you've had or the dispositions that you've had that has been anything less than absolutely consecrated to the living God. You listen to me now. You listen to me. Father wants to bring you to a place where there's absolutely no possibility of compromise in your life. Father wants to bring you to a place of revelation and knowledge in Him, relationship with Him. God, Father wants to so fill you with the fear of the Lord and the terror of the Lord that there would be no place of compromise. And so listen, I know what's going on right now. I am actually dealing with demon power right at this very moment. And, you know, I don't like to have to deal with demon power in the meeting, but that's okay. I'm good at it. Hallelujah. And at the end of this meeting tonight, that every power of darkness and every stronghold of the enemy will go with the body. And I pray that's not the case. Or it will go without the body. Amen. But one way or the other, it's going to go. And I'm certain that it will never return either way. I pray tonight you hear the word of the Lord and understand that Christ Jesus now stands over His church and He watches over His church. He stands in the midst of His church with eyes of a flame of fire. Some of you would think that that's what it's going to look like when He comes later. That's what it's going to look like on that day when He returns with a sharp two-edged sword in His mouth where He's going to slay the wicked. You know, you must understand something that is very difficult for it seemingly for a modern age to grasp a hold and to grab a hold of, and that is how much God hates iniquity and sin. How much God hates every dimension of those things that belong to the human condition. I got some quietness now, don't I? There's a bunch of people running around. There's false prophets. Must be false prophets to themselves. They always declaring things over themselves that God didn't say. You know what I'm saying? Quit being a false prophet to yourself. Are you listening to me? Hey, right now it's going to be better than a PowerPoint, I guarantee you. It's going to hit you. It's going to be a PowerPoint right to your heart. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hey, you know, the Lord is going to sort things out in your life. He wants to sort things out in your life. And He's very zealous for His church. God in His loving kindness and His tender mercy made a way to redeem men, and people sit around and act like that somehow they're going to cheat on God and do it their own way and make heaven. You're not going to make heaven. I don't care what your genealogies are. I don't care how sweet you are, huh? And how much you didn't mean to do it. God has made a way for every man to escape the realms of that which he totally hates. His fire and indignation is against. And I'm going to go after this for you tonight. I just want you to see Jesus Christ. His eyes are a flame of fire. His hair is white like wool. To look at Him, it's in the brightness, as it were, of the sun. It'll blind you. You just cannot possibly look at Him. I don't know if you've ever really had much of an encounter with the Holy Ghost and with the Lord Jesus Christ beyond just what you can conceptualize the earthly realm. But if you begin to look at the picture that the Word of God paints of Christ Jesus, of the living God and of the presence of the Lord, it's mighty awesome. I mean, you know, the seraphims can't stand to look. They just, you know, the pure seraphim angels, they can't stand to look. They cover their eyes. They cover their face. They can't stand to look. Hallelujah. They're really excited about things. With two wings they cover their feet, and with two wings they do fly. And I'm telling you, they do fly. They know how to make some. They got some moves going on. Praise God. They're not just standing there hovering, you know. I'm telling you right now, they're crying, holy, holy, holy. They're in awe of His purity. They're in awe of His holiness. They're in awe of His goodness. They're in awe of everything that belongs to His life. God made life, and He made life in the purity and the holiness and the goodness and the splendor of his own divine love and divine nature, and man rebelled against him and went after the rebel. They went after the things that belong to the realms of darkness, that which is opposed to God. And Father, in his love, came seeking man. He came seeking to save that which is lost. He came crying out for an Adam, saying, Adam, where are you? And Adam was hiding in his shame and his fear. And tonight I pray in the name of Jesus that there's no one here or watching me by the web that's going to run and hide in fear and shame. But you'll come. Let the light shine upon you. You'll come and you'll let everything about your life be exposed in Jesus' name. Tonight, we pray in Jesus' name tonight that there comes change in your life. That tonight there becomes the fear of God. We know the terror of the Lord. And thus, knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. Amen. And this is what we persuade men. That if one died for all, then all are dead. That we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves. If you live unto yourself, mark it right now. You're not right with God. If your life is about you, about your wishes, about your wants, to accommodate your weakness, your sickness, your disease, your sin, your earthly cares and concerns, you are not right with God. Your heart is not right. Everything about the death of Jesus Christ, our Passover lamb, everything about what he did for us was to bring us into a place where we're walking in oneness with him, where we escape the wrath that is to come, because the wrath of God abides on all sin and iniquity right now at this point in time. So I want you to open up your Bibles to Malachi chapter 3 and verse 2. And I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, you let the word of God shake you. I pray tonight that the fear of God will be so on you and the terror of the Lord so on you, there won't be any room for compromises in your life. There won't be any kind of doctrines that says you can have sin in your life and be right with God, because nothing could be further from the truth. There's nothing that could be absolutely more heresy and more blasphemous against the very nature of salvation than to say that you are in Christ and Christ is in you and that he is the minister of sin. That somehow you are walking in the spirit of divine holiness, being led by God, being instructed by God, and somehow you still are able to have some room or means by which you have an excuse to continue on in the things that belong to this world. The Lord says, seeing that we, dearly beloved, seeing that we've got all of these wonderful promises, therefore, cleanse yourself from the filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. The call for holiness and the gift of holiness that we've received. And of course, Paul is addressing those in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning of verse 14, that are righteous, not unrighteous, that are light, not darkness, that are Christ, not Belial, that are those who are the temple of the living God. For God said, I will dwell in you, I will walk in you, I will be your God, and you will be my people. Come out from among them, be separate, says the Lord, touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Having these promises, therefore, brethren, hallelujah. Hallelujah. The new covenant. The new covenant that Jeremiah talked about in Jeremiah 31:31, when he described how that God would bring us unto himself and he would purify a people unto himself to where that he would be our God, we would be his people, that he would cause us or make us to walk in his statutes, in his commandments, in his ways, in his divine glory. Hallelujah. He would give us a heart, one that's circumcised, a new one. Hallelujah. You know, Paul emphasizes it, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 16. Both of those describing those things that the prophet said concerning the new covenant, where everything about our life would be changed, where he would write his ways upon our heart and upon our mind, and we would do them. Hallelujah. People want to have an old nature. They want to have a doctrine about somehow there's some kind of a root of iniquity still on the inside of them so they can salve their iniquity. So they can have some kind of an excuse to go on in sin. But I'm going to tell you right now, Christ Jesus watches over his church right at this very moment with eyes of flame of fire. His breath is brimstone. Out of his mouth goes a sharp two-edged sword. He looks like he's on fire in the fire. His feet look like shining brass that is heated up to the maximum degree. Are you looking at him? That's him in the church right now. Oh, everybody wants you to be lowly lamb of Galilee that's just going to accept whatever it is that you give him. Huh? Listen, that's not God. And Father is totally dedicated to His Son being honored and His Son being glorified. I'm going to tell you right now, I pray in the name of Jesus, you'll listen to what's being said tonight and that you will understand that Father is not changing His word to accommodate you. I know you think you're special, but you're not that special. Christ Jesus is special and everything about His life. He ministered as though He didn't even count. He ministered as though He did not even count. He is always talking about, it's not me that you believe on. If you listen to my words, it's the Father that you're believing on because it's His words. You know, of course, He did say those that believe on me, you know, you're going to have eternal life. And He's talking about ultimately always bringing it back to the Father. Amen. That's what He's doing. So I'm going to just run a bunch of scriptures past you because this subject and this conversation and this topic is a little bit too much for anybody to believe. Because everybody's, you know, pretty much a lot of people just running around. They don't know what it means to tremble before His presence. They don't understand anything about the fear of the Lord. They don't understand His fiery indignation for which He's going to come and slay the wicked, where He's going to come and trample out the vineyard of His wrath. He's going to come and He's going to execute righteous judgment upon the iniquity of men and upon sin, and his garments as a result is going to be dipped in blood, saturated with the blood of men. Psalms 1:5 says, therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment. They say the ungodly is not standing, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. If you call yourself a sinner, your confession is a confession of death and you're a false prophet. But what is the chaff to the wheat, says the Lord? Nobody's standing around talking about how good or how bad the chaff is anyways. Huh? It's nothing. It's just lies. Hallelujah. It's the words of false prophets that cause the people to err, that is bent on sin, fat to do wickedness. Huh? Having eyes full of adultery, they cannot cease from sin. True. Having eyes full of adultery. Never has this scripture been so easily fulfilled as it is today. Having eyes full of adultery cannot cease from sin. Full of their lust. Full of their desire to continually contaminate and violate the things of the Spirit with their murmuring and their complaining. With their strife and their division. With their finger pointing. With their foul spirit born out of hell. With a tongue set on fire of hell, because they refuse tongues of fire from the Holy Ghost. I pray tonight, dear people, you come and you get yourself lined up with who God is, because He's not changing His word or His way to accommodate you, no matter how special your mama told you you were. Hallelujah. This is true. This is true. Psalms 5:5, the foolish shall not stand in His sight. He hates all those who work iniquity. Say, He hates
all those who work iniquity.
God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. But there is a demand for a change. Jesus said, if you'll just believe my words, if you'll obey my words, then my Father will love you. There will be a relationship love. God in His love and His compassion went calling out to an Adam who rebelled and disobeyed. He came moving to the spirit of the day, crying out to an Adam who walked away from Him, who violated the covenant, who violated the relationship. And He comes crying out in His love. The man separated. He had to drive him out of his garden. He had to drive him out of his presence. Until a way would be made back for him to come back in. He set up a veil in the temple, separating all mankind from Himself, saying, you can't come near me. Until one day, Jesus, our Passover lamb, about the time of the slaying of the Passover, at about 3:00 in the afternoon, the blood poured forth from His side and right out of the side, just as God had created Eve, Hava, from Adam. He from the side of Christ Jesus, He created one new man, you and me. He brought forth the creation, hallelujah, of a church, a glorious church. Has no spot. It's tamim. It's perfect. Has no blemish. It's holy. It's acceptable. Hallelujah unto God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. I've been washed in the blood. My garments are spotless, yea, they whiter than snow. Hallelujah. My soul said, Christ Jesus dwells in me. He dwells in me. Oh, praise the Lord. He dwells in me.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So many people want to have a Romans chapter 7 relationship with God. That's no relationship with God. That's condemnation. I would tell you, I'm taking myself a Romans chapter 6, Romans chapter 5, 6, and 8 relationship. I'm not going to go back under the law without the ability to do it. Hallelujah. That custom. Paul said that hag called Hagar, who gendereth bondage, which is Mount Sinai in Arabia, has been put to death. Praise God. Hallelujah. You have to just take Romans chapter 7, Galatians chapter 4 to understand that. But, you know, ooh, praise God. We the children of the promise. Pokotaya, the promise. We the children of the miracle. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are alive from the dead. Not to be held under the iniquity and under the bondage of sin or anything that belongs to the realm of iniquity ever again. See, Jesus was manifested to destroy the works of darkness. He stands over his church with his eyes a flame of fire right now. He's not feeling sorry or has any sympathy for anyone or anything. He's calling all men everywhere to repent. He's made a glorious way of salvation and escape for anybody who would just believe just a little bit. You crack the door of your heart to God and he'll come rushing in. Behold, he says to a church backslidden and lukewarm, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will open up, I will come in and dwell with you and fellowship with you and you with me. I'm there. Hallelujah. I'm on there. If there's anything that's Laodicean, we see it today. Laodicean is in a church in a state of growing apostasy. Laodicean is really to please the people. People demand you preach like me. You preach like I want you to preach. Well, God's raised up people who nobody can stop. God's raised up people. I don't know how he got in this place, but he just wrecked the whole thing. My goodness. And no, we'll never recover again. That's what Father's doing. He's raising up such an army of those who will not tolerate. They will not tolerate. It will be intolerable to have anything rather than heaven, anything rather than his divine power and his glory. They're going to stand as a contrast between that which is right and wrong. Father is going to make distinction between that which is holy and that which is profane. Yes, he is. Are you still at Malachi chapter 3, verse 2? I'm going to get there in a minute. Hang there. Don't go anywhere. Hallelujah. Somebody said, you're just a holiness preacher. Thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God said for you and I to be holy even as he is holy. That's exactly how he said it. He said, be holy just even as I am holy. That's what he said. He said, be perfect even as your Father in heaven is perfect. He said, be pure even as he is pure. He said, walk even as he walks. He said, you're righteous even as he's righteous. Hallelujah. People come sit in my meeting and it takes years of counseling to get over one meeting. Somebody go get counseling on, please tell me that he's not right. Please get another book out. Don't read the Bible because we're going to discover that everything he is saying is right there. And I'm going to be back in my problem. I want you to get out of your problem tonight. I want you to repent and be converted. Amen. Why don't you repent and be converted? Somebody said, why do you like to be in church all the time? Because church is the closest thing to heaven on earth. Praise God. I like heaven. Yeah. You can stay home and be in hell if you want. But I'm going to church and be in heaven. Of course, my home is heaven too. Hallelujah. But no, there's no place that like the church. The church is the fullness of him that filleth all things. You can't have church in your living room. He placed in the church first apostles, secondarily prophets. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Again, church in your living room. Couple people. Give me a break. That's not what Jesus is standing in the midst of, and he's watching over it. Because it's so important to him, it's so special to him. He loves the church so much he gave his own life for the church. I mean, the church is something to him that is so holy and so sacred, and everyone in the church has come into the church, that there's that wonderful, glorious mantle of the sacred upon our lives. We may not know how sacred we are, but we are very, very sacred. God is, we very holy to him. We very sacred to him. We need to get holy to ourselves and sacred to ourselves, so we'll quit profaning stuff, and especially his name. Amen. Are you listening to me? Yeah, you are. Hallelujah. Psalms 50, verse 3. Our God shall come and shall not keep silence. A fire shall devour before him, and it shall be very tempestuous. I mean, it will be explosions. It will be shaking. It will be shouts. It will be terrifying or tempestuous round about him. Psalm 76, 7. You, even you, are to be feared. And who may stand in your sight when once you are angry? Hello. And scripture makes it very clear he's angry with the wicked every day. He makes it very clear. Jesus told us, as I mentioned this morning, John chapter 3, verse 36, he says that you're either, you believed, you've been saved, and you have everlasting life, or you've refused to believe, and the wrath of God abides upon you. The Lord says he won't be mocked. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. If you sow to the flesh, you shall of the flesh reap corruption. You shall reap death and destruction. You sow to the Spirit, you're going to reap the life of God. That life is a quality of life and a quantity of life. It's a quality of life of his glory and his presence right now. It's a quantity of life in that it goes on forever. It has no diminishing. There's no death in it. Hey, God's got a life for you, no death in it. He's got heaven for you, got no hell in it. Hallelujah. He's got righteousness, got no sin in it. He's got a spirit of obedience, don't want no disobedience. It's the difference between God's people and the people who are just religious. There are many people that were born into religion. They were not born in the family of God. They were not washed in the blood. They were not made a new creature. A Holy Ghost never came upon them and transformed them into a new man. And they fill churches. I pray today you let God talk to you and you know for sure where you stand. And that you will understand that you'll know yourself by your fruits. And God expects that you have the fruits of the Holy Ghost in your life. Hallelujah. And I tell you right now, if you're not walking in love, you better get with the program real quickly. Hallelujah. You better be crying out to God. He's your Savior. He'll come save you. Hallelujah. He'll come strengthen you, help you, empower you. You're not walking in goodness. You better get in goodness quickly. Huh? Are you listening to me? You not enjoying and rejoicing? I'm telling you, you got evidence something's gone bad, gone wrong in your life. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise God is here. God is in this place. God is, hallelujah. God is in this place. He's watching over his word to hasten it. You know, I preach, there's always, you know, imagine the Father and Christ Jesus and the Holy Ghost on the front row. And I'm always looking to see how they're reacting. They're standing up right now. Moving. They're excited. Somebody's declaring the word. Somebody's calling men out of darkness. I mean, just think about John's ministry. He said, who warned you vipers to flee from the wrath that is to come? Repent and bring forth fruits that prove that you changed. I know how Father felt about him. And Father didn't change. Somebody said, you preach like John the Baptist, you're going to get beheaded. No, I'm preach like Jesus, get crucified. Hallelujah. 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 I'm going to tell you right now, you know, Paul is such a radical preacher, he barely made 30 years in the ministry till they took him and killed him. But in the meantime, he brought down the worship of the goddess Diana, who had been worshipped up to that moment in time about 3,000 years at least. And I'm telling you, gave the final blow, rather, to the Roman Empire. Or you could just say that maybe he didn't give the final blow, but he gave the crushing blow that was ultimately, it was just a matter of time before it collapsed. Amen. Hallelujah. Just think what you could do If Aristotle can, I mean, if Alexander the Great can sit at Aristotle's feet and learn how to be demon-possessed so that by the time he's 22, he can conquer the whole world under the power of a demonic angel from darkness in 3 years. 3 years. What will happen to you and I? We go ahead and let God, the Holy Ghost, fill us up, sit at the feet of the Holy Ghost, and learn how to move in Him. Come on, we're going to make disciples out of nations. We'll watch one nation after the next nation after the next. Praise God. What happened in Nepal? The great awakening that the Lord allowed us to bring to Nepal, the shaking of a nation that took place, that is all documented, and what God did through a bunch of nobodies, people full of His Spirit. Same thing's going to happen in Kashmir. Praise God. Hallelujah. It's already taking place in North Korea. That crazy kid that's running around, you know, that fat kid running around acting like he's got some kind of nuclear bomb, he don't even matter. He doesn't even matter. I tell you right now, the church in North Korea is radical right now. The North Korean church is powerful right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ha ha. I tell you right now, the church in North Korea is fiery. In 2006, there was such great outpourings of God going down in North Korea, I didn't even think it would last 10 years. And now it's bigger than ever. It's just a matter of time. Amen. I don't have to worry about them guys. While we're sitting over here, basically getting, flogged by the Lord. He chastens every son he receives and scourges them, flogs them. Amen. Because it's going to happen. People's coming. It's coming not because of Hillary or because of Obama or because of the Supreme Court, but because of a progressive, liberal, backslidden, sin-loving church. Are you listening to me? Yes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Sikato romonjiste kili manda pastefeo. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hora seto ramando rakista liparo. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I just want you to pray in the Holy Ghost for a few minutes. Say, Debre dando seki libita. Thank you, living God. Handam brosate eristaro. Hallelujah. Ando kurusheli karamambrebea. Hallelujah. Sidore danzo zala dengle siprado fredekaya shilombro sata. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Monza kita la la monzesi. Monza kise seremandoso serete. Hallelujah. Barana namando la veste sicura sefriti. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Besu Roman, Dura Sepro, Sure Befe, Idala Manokoshi, Ibreman and Ananda Lebeste, Lebembren and Amangle Stevri, Batula, Batevre Def. Hallelujah. 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 Bremamanda Kestevri, Babanda, Lebekestitifre, the Satost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the provision that you've made for us to be able to be right with you. Father, we thank you for the precious blood of Jesus that was poured out on Calvary so that we might be cleansed from every stain of sin. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, Father, for the work of grace. Thank you, Father, for the new creation. Thank you, Father God, that you caused us to be able to escape those things that are going to come upon the earth and to be able to stand before you, O living God. Father, I thank you that the yoke is broken right now and that there's not a single person in this place that will leave out of here under the Hallelujah. Under the influence of anything that is unlike you. Hallelujah. 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 Mama mandam bradest. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the authority of your word and the authority of your spirit that is being manifested in your people's life, that there will not be a single person in this place that will compromise with unholy things. Listen to me. You listen to me. You listen to me. I want to address in every way that I possibly can lying, deception, agreement with something that is so foul and so wrong, you will believe that you are right and you will die in your sins. And there's no way that I'm going to be able to address it if you're texting somebody in your life. You can't be in here texting. You can be taking notes with your phone, but you can't be texting. You can't be in this place resisting what God is saying by the Holy Ghost to you and expect that you're going to live too many days upon this earth, because there comes a place where people reject God one too many times. He gives everybody a space and time to repent. We act as though everything is going to remain as it is forever, but you're about ready to stand before the living God. Listen, I'm telling you, people, things are about ready to radically change. Understand me. The earth around us is right now moving in the direction of God's divine grace and judgments and mercies at this very moment. There is a great revival taking place in Asia, in like I said, North Korea and China and other places. It's America that is sitting here staggering in such unbelief, in such a terrible, terrible compromise that I'm not going to even go into. It's too depressing to talk about. Thing about it is, I just know too many things. How are you girls doing over here? Okay. Well, hurry back. I almost feel like just stopping, leading everybody in a prayer of repentance. Just because there's a few people in here, I'm telling you, I want you to just understand, there's a few folks in here tonight. You lied to yourself so long that Satan has got a stronghold in your life. And this thing is big now. It's gotten big. It's terrifying. Unless it's broken from off of your life, you're just going to get more self-justified. You'll become more religious, and you'll be just like a Pharisee. You'll look at Jesus right in the face and say, you got a devil. You won't be able to recognize the anointing. You won't be able to hear the word of God. You go, you move beyond the place of grace. It is a possibility to move beyond the state of grace and place of grace. It's called apostasy. It's where the Lord says he gave them over to a reprobate mind. He gave them because they did not want to retain God and their knowledge. They continued to resist the Holy Ghost. I mean, that's the situation with Isaiah and what he prophesied. He said, because they continued to disobey, they continued to refuse the word of the prophet. He said, seeing you should not see, hearing you should not hear, neither see your heart understand, so that you may be converted. Jesus went ahead and re-emphasized that with the nation of Israel as a whole. And so even Paul, by the end of the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 28, you hear him say the same thing. He just pronounced that judgment. Father, in his mercy and his grace through the new birth, has given us the privilege to have our eyes open so that we can see, to have our ears open so that we can hear, to have an understanding heart so that we can, hallelujah, repent and be converted. And now we can see what eyes have never seen, we can hear what ears have never heard, and we can understand what has never entered in the heart of man, because now God has come to reveal them to us by the Holy Ghost. But I'm just dealing with some things going on in this place tonight. I want to help you. I want you to understand that people have been lying to you, been lying to yourself. I'm telling you, it's a demonic stronghold when people do not crave, have a craving appetite for the word of God. It's a demonic stronghold when people do not have a craving appetite and literally are swept by the Spirit and the currents of God into a place of communion with Him, which we call prayer and praise. It is a demonic stronghold when you do not have any desire to be in the house of God. It is proof that you do not know Him, that you're not right with Him. They've gone out from among us that they may be made manifest that they are not of us. And John's talking about the church. He's not just talking about a single local church. He's just talking about the company of the church. I don't believe that people need to come to church here to be right with God, but I'm going to tell you right now, if they're right with God, they're going to be in church somewhere, and if they're right with God, they're going to be in church someplace where their people are hungry for the manifestation of the person, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the working of the Holy Ghost. Because otherwise, it's religion. What do you have if you're not passionately pursuing the manifestation of the Lord Jesus Christ to you and through you and the working power of the Holy Ghost in your midst, in your life, and among us? I mean, the Spirit of the Lord is manifested in the church. The Holy Ghost has been given to the church. Why? Because Father has purposed that the Spirit of the Lord be manifested in everybody's life. Now the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man so that we may be able to profit. In the midst of His church, the power of God is flowing with such unction that there's word of knowledge, word of wisdom, they're discerning the Spirit, working of miracles, gifts of healing, hallelujah, gift of faith, prophecy, tongues, interpretation of tongues. This is the church. You know, I was in Zambia. Last year I was in Zambia doing the conference for the missionaries and leaders of Overland Missions. And one night, this radical thing, the Lord spoke through me. And it was just kind of shocking. And the Lord said, I'm not interested in all the preaching and singing. And the place was hush. Because if we're not preaching and singing, what are we going to do? The Lord said, I want the flow of the anointing of the Holy Ghost that produces preaching and singing. Yeah. Come on, people. We've been taught wrong. We've allowed a culture to define for us what it means to move with God the Holy Ghost, and it's completely invalidated by the Word of God, by the Spirit of God, by the culture of the kingdom of God. It's time for us to start. It's time for us to return. Some people came to me, some men of God, I have many dear friends that God has raised up and doing wonderful things in the earth today. And they, we were talking, they're asking me some questions about revival. I said, well, you know, before you can have revival, you got to have a church turn back. Got to first turn back to God. People don't even, people think they're right with God because people are scared to get up in the pulpit and preach the truth. They're scared to let the light of God's word shine upon the hearts of people and sort them out and begin to deal with the reality of what is the proof and the evidence that you have the witness of the Holy Ghost in your life, that you have the witness of the truth in your life, that you have the witness of an obedient spirit in your life. And so first we got to turn back to God. We got to understand what the Word of God has called us to, what Jesus, the life that Jesus has called us into. Jesus Christ has called us into living out His life. We've received the life of Jesus Christ to live His life. We've not received the life of Jesus to go on with the cares of this life, the deceitfulness of riches, and the pleasures of this world, CRP. We're not called to live the CRP. Cares, riches, and pleasures. He said, because what's going to happen is that's going to result in you having a thorn bush of a lie where no fruit can be brought to perfection. And the Lord's really very clear with us because the light that He's called us to live, He told us to come and dwell in Him as a branch dwells in a vine. Man, that is you talk about radical declaration of sanctification. It's set apartness, I'm telling you. Hallelujah. That we dwell in Him. And He just made it very clear. He said, if you don't bring forth fruit, He said, you're going to wither. He said, you're going to be cast forth from the vine, and you're going to be gathered of men, and you're going to be burned. You're going to be just destroyed of the destroyer. You're going to be devoured by humanism. You're going to be devoured by men's doctrines. You're going to be devoured by earthly interest. The Lord says, you can't serve two masters. You're going to love the one and hate the other. And you're going to have to decide tonight who you love and who you hate. We've all got their excuses about why they live their life and why what's going on. You're not going to have any excuses first 2 seconds in the lake of fire. You're going to be screaming and ain't going to be nobody to hear you. You listen to me. Esau tried to repent. He didn't care anything about the birthright. He didn't care anything about the inheritance either. Well, he had a little bit more interest in the inheritance. But you can't have the inheritance if you don't have the birthright. Huh? And he saw it with bitter weepings and crying, but there was no place of repentance found for him. He went too far with the thing. He missed his opportunity. The Lord says that we assuredly perish if we neglect so great a salvation. We got to hear what God is saying here. We got to hear what God is saying. I have so many verses of scripture to begin to take you through, because all the prophets screamed out at the top of their voice concerning the day of his wrath, the day of his indignation, the day where he's going to hold back no more, and he's going to come and he's going to bring us in to sin and iniquity. Somebody said, well, why does he allow it? He allows it as a testimony to men and to angels that the smallest little bit of sin will result in men wanting to completely and entirely do away with God altogether. Because they will say, come, let us destroy him. Let us go up and break off his bands from off of us. And his restraints, we can remove them. That's Armageddon. Men will come up to fight against God and to destroy God. Are you listening to me? The little bit of sin, a little bit of disobedience will ultimately result in you not wanting God even in the equation. You don't even want God around. It's not even, you can't even tolerate his right to exist. This is where the world goes. This is where the world is going around us. And to be a part of the world, and to be influenced by the world, and to be involved with the world, God says you're his enemy. God said you're his enemy. God said friendship with the world is an act of treason and hostility against him. It is amazing how many people don't go to church and all their excuses. Well, I went to church and I got hurt. I don't go to church because there's no real church. There's nobody really seeking God. My goodness gracious, all a bunch of lies. So you really seeking God while you're at home? Give me a break. You got all these excuses why you don't go to the meeting, why you're not involved in church anywhere. Those of you who are watching the web right now, I'm telling you, if you're in San Diego County, you're wrong. You're not supposed to be even, I wish I had a filter and a block on the web that nobody in San Diego County could even watch. If you, other people, other places, praise God, we're glad you're watching. If you're watching in San Diego County, you should be ashamed of yourself. You need to repent, get right with God. Malachi chapter 3, verse 4. Verse 2, rather. But who will be able to abide? Who will be able to stand in the day of his coming? And who will be able to abide? Forgive me. The day of his coming, and who shall be able to stand when he appears? Because it's going to be dreadful. His eyes are like a flame of fire, watching over his church right now. Ready to say to everyone, he's searching, his eyes search, his eyelids try. He looks at church at Ephesus. He said, yeah, you've been doing really good. You know, there's things that are noteworthy in your life. But I'm going to tell you right now, I have something against you, and you repent right now, or I'm going to come and judge you. And he goes through the list. And I mean, the church at Ephesus, that was pretty good. They were doing pretty well. I'm going to tell you, you better get right with God. I'm telling you right now, you better get right with God. I'm telling you right now, you better get right with God. You don't have too much time. You think you got a lot of time. You don't have a lot of time. Father is here tonight. I know where I've been doing this for 32 years. I know what I'm doing. There's people here tonight. There's a few people here tonight that God is pleading with their souls. He's pleading with them. I've been here before. I've watched the thing go down. And I'm not going to dilute the plea, because really the Holy Ghost is the pleader. Yeah. We say he's the comforter. He's the pleader.
Yeah.
The paragaletos is the pleader. He pleads with men. He pleads. He cries out to the sons of men. He cries out to the hearts. Why will you perish? Why won't you hear? Why don't you repent and turn? Every word of God is pure, it's tried, and every word of God will judge you, and every word of God is by definition demanded of God that you obey it. And if you do not obey it, your faith is superficial. It is not saving faith, because the hearers are not justified. Those people who do God's word, and at the heart of doing God's word is fundamentally not only living the life of Jesus, but walking in the life of Jesus with a total devotion and consecration and holy fear, knowing the terror of the Lord, we thus persuade men. That's a radical argument in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning in verse 12. That's a radical argument. Knowing the terror of the Lord, we thus persuade men that if one died for all, then all are dead, that we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves, but to live unto him who died for us and then rose again. And then, of course, that goes into the crescendo of, you know, that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, new creation. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things are new. Not some things, say all things, are new, and all things are of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are all things about your life new? Are all things about your life new? Then you have a witness and evidence that you've been born again. Are all things about your life not new? Then you got yourself a problem. Are all things of God? Then you have a witness that you've been born again. Jesus said to the woman at the well, he said, if you'll recognize who I am, I'm going to just put it to you in a free-flowing translation. If you recognize who I am and the gift that I have for you, the gift of God, you will never thirst again. You will never desire the things of this world again. But you will have a well springing up on the inside of you, providing the very life of God. And what he's saying is it will fill you with everything that your heart has ever longed for. And she went and told everybody that she ran into a prophet that told her everything that she ever done and revealed to her everything that she'd ever desired. I mean, that's really the complete message of what she said, declared. Hallelujah. I want Jesus' salvation. I want the gift of God that he talked about, that he revealed. I don't want some kind of substitute. I don't want some kind of a religious idea, a religious notion, a religious counterfeit of what God has made available. I'm interested in the same glorious salvation that Paul encountered when he talks about how that Christ Jesus was manifested in his mortal flesh and all the other wonderful things that he said with such lofty terms concerning Christ Jesus and his glory and his power being revealed in his life, in our life, because we're the temple of God. Amen. How can the temple of God have any agreement with idols? And you think about the idols of this world. The idols, anything that stands between you and being in church is an idol. Anything that stands between you and flowing in the Holy Ghost, you're bowing your knee to some demand of a demon spirit.
Yes, it's true.
I know how to walk in the fullness of God. Be continually filled. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the Lord's made the privilege, give us the privilege to be continually filled. Yes. Somebody said, what's the difference between being filled and being baptized in the Holy Ghost? Nothing. Nothing. Acts 1:5, Jesus said, you'll be baptized not many days from now. Acts 2:4, when they were baptized, they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Baptized, filled, by definition, equivalent. Hallelujah. And many other examples as well. Hallelujah. Ha ha. Hallelujah. It's lots of fun to continually be baptized in the Holy Ghost, isn't it? Hallelujah. I tell you, just think about it. All the good things that we have that Father has bestowed upon us, giving us all the blessings. Think about it, dear people. Look, he's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in a heavenly realm, and we're going to just turn up our nose at that and go occupy ourselves with a world that is violently opposed to him and that he is militant against, that Christ Jesus, who stands as a purifier to purify the one who comes with fire and indignation to slay the ungodly. We're going to go over there and participate with that which is the very object of his indignation, of his wrath, when he's given us such a privilege to walk in all day, be filled with goodness. You know what goodness is? Whew. Huh? You know what goodness is? Huh? You know, Moses said, I just got to see more of your glory. I just got to see you in fullness of glory. The Lord says, you can't see me and live. And it's like Moses didn't even hear that. It's like, you know, he didn't even care. Dead didn't matter to him. Not being able to live didn't even matter to him. That just went right by him. He said, I want to see you. And the Lord said, I caused my goodness to pass before you. Hallelujah. I'm hungry for his goodness to pass before me right now. I'm hungry for his goodness in this place tonight. I'm hungry. I'm hungry to see every person walk out of here desperate with God pleading with you that every one of you walk out of here delivered from the foul spirits of hell that have tormented you, had harassed you, and sorted you out from the flock of God. There's a few people in here tonight. This is about your eighth time being in church this year. You're not right with God. You're not right with God. Somebody say you got to go to church to be right with God? Yes. Yeah, you do. Where does that say in the scripture? I don't have as much. Would you like to go into it? We're going to spend many hours. Hallelujah. The church is the kingdom of God. It's the vehicle of the kingdom of God. It's the expression of the kingdom of God. And Father told you to put it first. Above all things, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And he said, and he made it absolutely essential. Hallelujah. 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 I mean, I just say over and again, if you just took Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7 and start being a doer, hallelujah, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, instead of a hearer, your whole life would be changed. And it would be good change. Whew, you'd be blessed. Why do people want to carouse with demon spirits living hate and division and sorrow and grief when all the time they could be living in joy and refreshing glory and goodness and fellowship and everything's good, walk around in heaven, hallelujah, hallelujah, every good and perfect thing. People say, oh, well, we just don't have enough ability. God understands the human frame. No, he don't understand no human frame. A new nation was born. A new man was born. When Abraham responded to God and came out from among them, God started a new nation. A new nation was born. A new race was born in Abraham. Today they call Jews. In Christ Jesus, a new nation was born. A new family. Hallelujah. Hurrah. We became the sons of God. People say, oh, well, we're all children of God. No, it's not true. Jesus even told people who belonged to religion, the right religion. He said, looked at them because they were religious. And didn't want to hear God and obey God. He said, your father is the devil. Huh? There's only one way to ultimately have Father as your God, and that is to be born of the Spirit. Amen. Yes. Become Amen. Brethren with Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. His royal blood now flows through my veins. He lives in me. Amen. We a new race.
Yeah.
I don't care whether you're Filipino. I don't care what it is. Pinto, whatever, you know. European, I mean, you know. Doesn't matter what you are. Indian, Hispanic, it doesn't even matter. It doesn't even matter whether you're what color you are. You can be purple. It doesn't even matter. Black, white, green. It doesn't even matter. God's made one new man, one new nation. He made a holy nation, one new man, a royal priesthood. He brought us all together in him. Hallelujah. The family of God. You know, the Lord says it over and over again. He puts such emphasis on this. Listen to me. He puts such emphasis on this. He says, beloved, now are we the sons of God. So what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we should be, but we know that when we see him, we shall see him as he is, for we shall be like him. And everyone who has this hope or confidence purifies themselves even as he is pure. Hallelujah. And Peter said something right along the same line. He goes and he says to us, according to his divine power, he's given us everything that we need to walk in glory and purity. We're without excuse. According to his divine power, 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3, he gave us everything that we need. Hallelujah. According to his divine power, he gave us everything that pertains to life and godliness. His life, the life of Jesus Christ, the life of God, the life of the Holy Ghost. We refuse it because we don't go to church. Because Christ Jesus is in the midst of his church.
his gifts in the midst of his church. He gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers and set them down in his church. And that's the way saints get perfected, and I know of no other provision. And that's the way they get built up, and I didn't hear about any other provision. And either way, if you're not getting perfected and built up, you messed up. You sorted out to be proven that you need to get right with God. And Father's not going to change. Oh, I'm going to accommodate it for so-and-so because they are just so sweet. And they so delightful. And they didn't do a single thing hardly that I told them to do, but we're just going to go ahead and give them a pass. No, you take a person who's unrighteous, put them in the land of the upright, and they'll do wickedly still. You take a rebellious person, there's people that are just stubborn and rebellious, and they proud of it. Well, the Lord says it's witchcraft. It's same as witchcraft. People all concerned about witchcraft. Oh, no, the rise of the Satanist church in America. Man, give me a break. It's all over the place. Stubbornness, rebellion. There's two angels right now that rule real dominantly in the United States of America. Feminism and humanism. Such power of rebellion against God. There's a third one joined in, intellectualism. With those three, they pretty much got everybody occupied. Oh, yeah. Does I know what I'm talking about? Yeah. Hallelujah. We're here to break off the yoke.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're here to smash them. Amen. My dear smashing friend will be here next weekend. Right, baby? My smashing friend, Evangelist Tim Hall. Hallelujah. My. When you have so many miracles, signs, and wonders in your crusades that the government goes ahead and pays for them, hey, things are happening. Amen. He smashes stuff that belongs to the powers of darkness. He's going to be here. He's going to be with me. I didn't realize he was going to stay with us several days, so we're going to go ahead and do at least a couple of days of meeting. He's coming in, what, baby, on Saturday? So he's going to be here May 8th, Sunday night, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and we're going to at least do one service May 9th, Monday night. Huh? And we might go in Tuesday night. I just don't want to wear him out. I know he's worn out. I mean, he's been all over the earth. I mean, God just shaking so many nations. Praise God for the men of God, champions of God. Hallelujah. Pokoro sataya la mandefia talomocha. Hallelujah. If you've never heard of Tim Hall, and you're watching me, or you're here right now, or you're watching me by the web, just go to www.timhallministries. You'll see it's radical, it's powerful, how God's used him over the past 40 years to just shake nations, just radical signs, wonders, and miracles. Pura sataraneya. He loves this church, he loves us, he loves me, especially loves Anne. And his wife Jackie's gonna be with him, so, hallelujah. Bring the sick, the diseased, the crippled, the lame, whatever. Bring them. With the seed of the Lord, heal them. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Kutarabasi kistilima. Hallelujah. Brondai. Brupataya. Eresti fritano. Hallelujah. Brombande. Extilimase. I tell you right now, we're getting some things done. I'm telling you, we're moving some things around in here. Listen, praise God for the Holy Ghost Church. Moving things around here. I'm telling you, there ain't nobody in the place going to be the same. Dig it. Doesn't even matter. It's just impossible. You're going to be haunted. If you reject what God's saying, you're going to be haunted. Hallelujah. Who shall abide the day of his coming? Well, I'm going to just go ahead and skip past Isaiah and skip past Ezekiel and skip past Zephaniah on this and Nahum. Because they have very similar things to say concerning the day of his coming. And I just want to go quickly over to Romans chapter 1. Quickly, Romans chapter 1. Just look with me here quickly. Just going to stop off a couple of verses of scripture. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence. Isn't God so good? Yes. Isn't he just one? Isn't he amazing? Yes. Hallelujah. He loves us so much. He loves us so much. He loves us dearly and has no possibility of understanding how that we could step in to such a grace and such a glory
and such a divine provision where he withheld nothing of his life and glory and power from us, and we could reject that and turn away from it. He has no ability to understand that. He has no ability to understand that. He has no, it is so dishonoring to him that is an entirely different level of wrath. It is. It's an entirely different level of indignation and anger. How that God, how that we could allow or be even begin to understand the beauty of all that he's prepared for us in Christ Jesus and taste of the power of the world to come, and then to begin to to reject that and turn away from it. Says there's no even possibility. He's not even listening. It's not even possible to restore such a one. Not even possible. Because it's just the way he feels about it. People don't hear these things. This is the way he feels about it. Paul says in Romans chapter 1, verse 18, he says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness." You think about Enoch and how that Enoch prophesied concerning the things of God's fire of judgment and indignation. He said, God's coming with 10,000 of his saints to execute judgment upon all the ungodly for the ungodly deeds which they ungodly commit. People walk around in the church having received the outpouring of that which is sacred, having a whole nother level of responsibility, having received so much more than anybody else since the days of Adam. And then we walk around saying, trying to look for an excuse to walk in unrighteousness and ungodliness. I'll tell you right now, the wrath of God abides upon it. Father has given to us the spirit of righteousness. He's given us the spirit of obedience. He's given us this. He's given us his sacredness. He's given us his glory. He's given us his goodness. He's given us all power. He's given us all ability. He's given us all power and authority over all unclean spirits and all sicknesses and all diseases. As many as believed him, he gave them the authority to be the sons of God. As many as received and who believed upon his name, as many as received, he gave them the authority to be the sons of God. As many as believed upon that all-powerful name, the transforming, powerful name of Jesus. Paul goes on to say, because that which is made known of God is manifested to them, for God hath showed it unto them. He's made very clear what's right and what's wrong. He's made very clear how he feels about unrighteousness. He made very, very clear that he's given us all authority and power to be able to do what he's called us to do. And there's no tolerance. There's going to be simply no tolerance for anything less. Go to Romans chapter 2. The Lord tells us here, he says, beginning in verse 14. Let's see, where do I want to begin here? Pull yourself together. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, living God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I tell you what, let's just jump over to 2 Peter chapter 3. I really don't even know where to break into to Romans chapter 2. Go to 2 Peter chapter 3. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, living God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for causing the deaf ears to hear. Thank you, Father, for causing blind eyes to see. Thank you, Father God, for causing hearts that have waxed gross and dull of hearing to hear. Father, we thank you that in your mercy you'll melt the hardest heart. Father, we thank you that in your mercy, Lord God, you'll bring your presence and cause such a fiery Holy Ghost conviction to burn within someone's belly and burn within someone's life that they cannot resist.
Yes, Lord.
Jesus. Jesus. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. Verse 5, for this they willingly are ignorant of that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was overflowed with water and perished. People who say, well, you know, the law has been removed, and without the law, you know, there is no... They even take it to the point of saying that there is no sin, because that the law was the strength of sin or revealed sin. Just go off on some crazy ideas and notions. Listen, dear people, that's not even what Paul was talking about when he was saying that the strength of sin is the law. It's not even what he was saying. He was just helping people to understand that the law was there purposefully to reveal man's sin and iniquity and otherness from God, their separation from God. Because in the first 1,565 years of creation, man finds himself so under a demonic onslaught of the powers of darkness, so yielded to that realm of iniquity, and there was no law, and God judged the world. And as it stands as a witness and a testimony, the Father's going to wipe it out. And there's just no getting around it. There's no getting around it. Somebody said, well, the cross did away with that. No, it didn't. The cross did away with sin and iniquity holding its sway over those who want to be set free, because Jesus died for people who want to be set free. Jesus died for those who want to escape from sin, not for those who want to stay in it. Verse 7, but the heavens and the earth which are now, by the same word, by the same person who spoke the word then, by the same one who executed his judgment then, by the same word, by the same authority, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the judgment and perdition of ungodly men. There is coming a day in the not too distant future where you're going to stand and be judged by God at the very moment that you breathe out your last breath. Somebody said, there's no judgment going on right now. It's all mercy. There are people dying by the thousands and the tens of thousands and the hundreds of thousands every day. Judgment is falling every day. Every single day. People are waking up in hell every single day. Every day, people are breathing out their last breath and lifting up their eyes in hell and being in torment. The flood, Noah's flood, things that we can talk about other than that, Sodom and Gomorrah, all of those things are evidence to us and a declaration of God's judgment and how he feels about sin and how he feels about iniquity. And to believe that somehow that judgment of God is changed, that Father is different now, that's just deception. To believe that your sin is okay, that somehow it's covered by the blood, there's no such thing in the scripture as covering. There's not even a covering. That is a mistranslation. There's not even a covering in the Old Testament. God purgates it. He does away with it. The reality of it is people have not found the place of relationship with God to where that they can live lives that he died and rose again for us to have. You are going to have to be willing to be in him and allow him to be in you. Yeah, it's not going to even happen if you're not willing to obey God's word, if you're not willing to participate with those things which he's doing. There's absolutely no way that you're going to live the life of the overcomer. He demands above everything else that we overcome. He says, if you overcome as I overcame, then you will sit down with me in my throne. As I sit down with my Father in his throne, he has given to us the very definition of what it means to overcome, his example. Are you going to do it?
Yes.
The question is, are you willing to receive his so great of salvation, his empowerment, his ability? God's not looking for us to step up with our ability. It's not by our strength. It's not by our power, but it's by our totally giving ourselves completely over to living this life in the Spirit. As many as are led by the Holy Ghost, they are the sons of God. As many as walk in the Spirit, as live in the Spirit, these are the people who are the family of God, and living and walking and being led by, being under the leadership of, being the temple of, being ruled by, governed by the Holy Ghost has always the same consequence. You begin to live out the word. But the Lord says, don't be ignorant. God hasn't changed. He feels the same way today as he did 1,000 years ago. 1,000 years ago is today. Put 10,000 there is a day. Or 100,000. He's not changed. God's not changed. God's not discovering. God's not learning. God in his mercy and his long suffering with men, not willing that any perish, continues to do with men. And continues to cry out and plead with the sons of men to change. The Lord's not slack concerning his promises, as some men count slackness, but as long-suffering. I just said that. I just quoted that. Not willing that any perish, but everybody come to repentance. Verse 10. But the day of the Lord will come. The day of the Lord will come for all men, and you're going to see what, we all see what that looks like. The day of the Lord is going to come for all mankind, and we see what that looks like in the book of Revelation. We see what it looks like in Isaiah. We see what it looks like in Daniel. We see what it looks like in Zechariah. See in part what it looks like in Malachi. We see what it looks like. Let me help. In so many of the descriptions of the prophets of old, and it's not a pretty sight. It's God unleashing his anger and his wrath against all sin and against all ungodliness, and especially against those who hold the truth in unrighteousness. And really, when Paul begins to address those things in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 concerning the man of perdition, he actually begins to address a spiritual state of people in the church in Thessalonica at the time. He begins to draw out parallels with the Antichrist and the man of perdition, the one who exalts himself as God, tries to exalt himself above God. Listen to me. And he begins to relate it to the way that people were behaving themselves in the church, holding the truth in unrighteousness. There is a just judgment that is going to fall upon people who have been given so much, who've been given the precious blood of Jesus Christ to wash them and cleanse them, who've been given the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of holiness without measure, who've been given the privilege and the opportunity to be the very dwelling place of God, who have been gifted and graced with all the power of God, all heaven mobilized to come to our aid. And we are willing to set that aside by some false doctrines and by some lies and by some excuses where we believe that we're in this world and can continue to act like this world. Jesus said, you're not of this world, even as I'm not of this world. He tells us to come out from this world, come out from among them, come out from the world and have nothing to do with it. Don't touch it. Then you will be his sons and daughters. Then he will be your God. That's Paul's radical teaching. That's Paul's radical teaching. Of 2 Corinthians chapter 6, it's a radical teaching of the Apostle Paul, the grace preacher. He said the grace of God has been revealed from heaven, teaches all men that you are to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. You're going to have to find a place of zero tolerance, people.
You still got my Bible open? I just want to read a couple of verses, a couple more verses of scripture. Then I want to pray for some people. I want to have a prayer meeting with you. I want you to reach out with me. Bring her back. Calm her down and bring her back. Because you need to be here. We're going to have a prayer meeting with you that the fire of God and the fear of God, the reality of His presence and His purpose will rest upon your heart and your life. Because if there's a people in the earth who's willing to give themselves over to perfect obedience, to walk with Father the way that He demands, there's going to be a people then He's going to show forth His glory and power through. You know? In the first great awakening, there's nobody in this. There's hardly anybody on the planet today that even can relate to the sermons of Jonathan Edwards and George Whitfield and others. Can't even relate to sinners in the hands of an angry God. Somebody's tried to modify that and put sinners in the hands of a loving God. Get your humanist stuff out of here. He is a loving God, but I know exactly where they're going with that. And it's not going to create a great awakening because it's not going to result in people coming under Holy Ghost conviction because people have so rebelled against God that they have just, their hearts have become hardened against Holy Ghost conviction. It's a scary thing. Your fingers covering them. Verse 10. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. You got sin in your life? You got yourself a serious problem with the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm telling you right now, His eyes are a flame of fire, and He's breathing brimstone. He's breathing brimstone. His nostrils are inflared, which is the Hebrew phrase for how we translate anger. You know, He's mad. He's angry. God is angry with the wicked every day. God is angry with people who come in the church like Korah and Dathan and say, we're anointed too. We know the word of God too. He's angry. That was Jonathan Edwards, pretty much his sermon on dealing with those who were in the camp and the people of God who were sanctified by the Lord to be in His midst, who had been chosen by God, but because of their nature, because of the rebellion, because of the stubbornness, the earth opened up and swallowed them, and they fell straight down into the lake of fire. And He's not changing His judgment, dear people. You better get enough fear and reality of the way that God feels about sin so that you can begin to allow the Holy Ghost to work in you and produce the same attitude and the same anger and the same fiery indignation against any sin that would come along to you, knocking on your door, trying to talk you into allowing it to entertain you. Amen. You better understand that you sow to the flesh, you shall have the flesh reap corruption. You better understand that you have been privileged with the Lord Jesus Christ to put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. Yeah. You're just going to have to understand that they who walk in the Spirit will not fulfill any form of that iniquity. That's just the message. What are you going to do? Continue to have an excuse why you can go on participating with the world because other people that you know do so? And so you figure you can too? Come on, people, why don't you step over here in the Holy Ghost? Get carried away in the things of the Spirit. Come on, let's go back into the days of being translated from one place to the next. Let's go ahead and start walking on the water, commanding the winds and waves. That's a whole lot better stuff to do. Come on, let's go ahead and start casting out devils. I love authority over demon spirits. My wife and I stood on a platform in a nation that had never heard the gospel, in a place where people said it could never be done and it never would be done. It was impossible because it was the icon of the kingdom of Hinduism. And all we did was wave and say hello. And people by the thousands and the multitudes, demon spirits just went out of them with just their little hello. In the Church of the United States of America, people have become so stubborn and so hard and so arrogant against God, they stand there defiant against all authority. Don't even budge. They're just like the Pharisee and the Sadducee and the scribe and the doctors of the law. They were all there. All the Pharisees and the doctors of the law, the doctors. It came out from all the regions all around about, and they were gathered in the place, and there was the power of God to heal, but all they had was all their intellect. Took four country boys to bring the power down. Hallelujah. Took four country boys, said, we're going to tear that roof off, man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. You better get right. Huh? You better not think you right. You better know you right. You better have proof you right. You have better have evidence you right. Huh? You better have nature right. Huh? Holy Ghost witness right. Huh? Word of God testimony right. Because you're a doer of the word. Because you walk in the realms of God, the Holy Ghost. Because you live out the life of Jesus. Because I'm telling you right now, you've been lied to. Anything less, God's wrath abides upon it. Anything less, God refuses. It's unacceptable. Unless it's in Christ Jesus, and Christ Jesus in you, totally unacceptable to God. Totally unacceptable. Nothing but religion. Nothing but heresy. Nothing but lies. It's true. It's true. And America goes the way that it goes because the church has been overrun. Praise God for turning back. There's a turning back coming. People all upset at the millennials because the millennials don't care nothing about working, getting money, having a job, having a house, having a car. God's preparing himself for people. Watch out. The millennials are coming. They don't care nothing about the CRP. Hallelujah. I don't care nothing about the cares, the riches, and pleasures. God, they radical sinners right now. All they can do is think of Bernie as a good president, socialism and free stuff. But watch what's going to happen, man. Yeah. When the free stuff ain't working out. Hallelujah. And the power of God begins to show forth his glory through your lives because you radically turn yourself over. Listen, the Lord's not going to prepare a harvest to be brought in and to be ruined by a bunch of religion. People sitting around all frowny and talking bad about each other and murmuring and complaining. Just going to ruin it. Father's going to have them people itself. Father's going to have a radical people. The core of it's going to be fiery. It's going to be fiery. Because you look at every great revival of the past, that's what happened. There was a core of it that was fiery. And people came around and they got fiery too. And there was no lukewarm nothing. It's just fiery. You know, it's so hard for people to notice that they lukewarm. Well, let me help you. Unless you baptize on fire of the Holy Ghost, you lukewarm. Yeah. Or you're cold. Yeah. Huh? Yeah. At best, you're cold. I'd rather be cold than lukewarm. Because the Lord says, here's what I'm going to do with you. Okay? It is the greatest, probably one of the worst insults that you can give. Are you ready? Can I just get dramatic with you? Will you let me get dramatic? Because I just want to make a point. Those of you who stand around, worship the Lord, talking about how much he loves you. How much you love him. How much you know him. Huh? How you pray all the time. My goodness. You know, there's just a bunch of nonsense going down. Watch people do this stuff. And they're not fiery with God. They're not walking out this life in God. They're just lying. The Lord says, it's a thing, you know. You can still see it in Middle East cultures today. Somebody hands you a drink and you go. You throw it back in their face. Says, I want nothing to do with you. Get away from me. He said, I'll spew you out of my mouth. He says, you walk around lukewarm, I'm telling you, get away from me. He says, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. Depart from me, you who practice sin, who allow sin to go on in your life. I do not know you. I do not know you exist. You do not exist to me. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
People, it's about time we get a hold of ourselves.
Yes.
Quit cheating.
Yes.
Quit going a whoring after the things of this world.
Yes.
Huh?
Thank you, Lord.
You just need to read the Bible. They need to understand that you don't read the Bible, read the Word of God, so that you don't fall after the same manner of unbelief.
Yes.
Their carcasses fell in the wilderness. Why? Huh? Because of unbelief. The word preached to them did not profit them. They continued on looking about like you look right now. Murmuring and complaining. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I got a heat-seeking missile. I know everybody in here who's messing with God. You better repent. Huh? And if any of you provoke me, I'll start talking to you like John the Baptist talked to the Pharisees. And this is a fiery Holy Ghost prayer prayer bench right here. Hallelujah. I just don't want the leaven coming in and spoiling the party. I don't even want the stinking leaven. We're going to get you converted. We got a goat changing machine. Go in a goat, come out a sheep. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. God, hallelujah. 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 We got a regenerator. Hallelujah. Paul describes salvation as water, the washing of regeneration. Ooh, and renewing of the Holy Ghost. That's salvation. Huh? Our spirit is Holy Spirit. Huh, Bokata. Our body. Huh? Our body, the members of Christ. Huh?
Hallelujah.
Huh? The members, the servants unto holiness. Huh? And the fruit thereof. The fruit is holiness, and the end thereof, everlasting life. Romans 6:22. Praise God. Hey, come on, people. The day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, the elements shall melt with a fervent heat, the earth also and the works therein shall be burned up. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in every holy conversation and godliness? That's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Seeing as the way God feels about iniquity and sin, how much of it are you going to allow in your life? How much of it are you going to self-justify? Right. People, listen, you know, here's Elizabeth. Because we started talking about how we're going to be able to break in to the media, especially filmmaking, and begin to do something that has never been done before. You got to be fenced with iron. She goes in, and they tell her early on in film school, they tell her, "Oh no, you have to have immorality in your movies. It's part of the key. You got to have some sex, and you got to have some drugs, and you got to have some killing, and you got to have some cussing. Otherwise, it doesn't sell." These are formulas that they use. And Elizabeth said, "I'm not going to do it." They said, "You need to get another major. This is because it's not going to work." Huh? What we know, first of all, we know how successful she was. I don't have to go in that. I mean, when you get 2 Emmys, you're pretty good. Okay, but anyway. God just blesses his people, right?
Yeah.
I said, "Well, I'm not going to get into that." People sit around and watch things that were designed by the satanic realm to defile your temple. You're just going to have to stop it. You're just going to have to stop it. Everybody admires the radical faith of Wigglesworth. but they don't admire his radical consecration. People would admire the radical faith of John G. Lake and P.C. Nelson, but they don't admire consecration. And I could go on. People admire the radical faith of Mariah Woodworth Eder, but they don't admire the consecration. I'm going to tell you right now, you're not going to have the display of the life and power of God with the life and the power of Jesus without the consecration. Praise God for it. So that there will be a distinction made. So everybody needs to look at themselves, see what's going on in your life. Verse 12, looking for and hastening unto the coming day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with a fervent heat. That's how Father feels about sin. What sin? The sin that you might allow. The sin that you tripped up into and got some excuse. Huh? Give me a break. Adam's disobedience is not greater than Christ Jesus' obedience. The effect of Adam's transgression is not greater than the effect of Christ Jesus' righteousness. Read Romans chapter 5. Satan has never been stronger and more powerful and more effective than God. Huh? Darkness doesn't have a chance against light. In fact, really, darkness doesn't even exist. Amen. We won't go into that. Amen. Can't study darkness. You can study light. It exists. Are you with me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
We can go on like this all night. Amen. We're pleading with you.
Thank you.
I'm pleading with you. I'm pleading with you. Quit compromising. I'm pleading with you. He consecrated you with his blood. He consecrated you with the Holy Ghost. He set you apart and made you holiness. Huh? That's right, baby. Come on now. Hallelujah. I'm building up myself in my most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. I'm going to keep myself in the love of God.
Amen.
I'm not going to hell.
No.
I'm not even going to run a remote risk of looking anything like the devil or being marked with the center of his iniquity. Hallelujah. We're calling all men to repentance. We're calling all men to change. God's calling. That's what we're commanded to do. We call all men to change. We call all men to repent.
Amen.
Nevertheless, we, according to the promise, look for a new heaven and a new earth wherein dwells righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that you look for such things, be diligent that you may be found in him in peace, without spot and blameless. Without spot. See, you're just going to have to excuse me. I hate the garments spotted with the flesh. Are you listening to me? Take who, shepherd. Everybody stand with me. Hallelujah. 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 Hambata la bekisi ti ar mahari hare bestiti di candela la fasifra paravra de kitia del masus barata la di kitia la vede masu pre bevete che shira barata la tete che era per mosha pre vai berno bo si kinga vede bevesti fi si sandola la per fare de disiala alleluia alleluia breve ta comba la basing de le vesti di vita la mamma non va bevete di disti andando la bevete ti Alandola the bit of Titi Kita Resta Parala. A mamba the Pakista did a libitamba the boat of Sifriti. Alamba the Tatak over the bit to see the test. There is a time where God would overlook, where God overlooked sin and iniquity, but now he commands all men to repent. Father's calling you to a place tonight of deciding that there's things that have been going on in your life that you know aren't right. There's things that you've been allowing. And you know that you can say no to them. You know that you can shut them off from your life. And Father demands it tonight. There's bad attitudes going on in people's lives. There's places where that there's relationship issues that are all messed up. There's unforgiveness going on in people's lives in this place. There's just out and out sin. You know, the thing about it is Proverbs chapter 7, you know, Satan knows what he's doing. He's very strategic about it, you know, because the Lord says fornication defiles the temple, sexual immorality, porneia. It defiles the temple, and God says, I will destroy the person who defiles my temple in hell. I will destroy it. That's what Father says. And people, there is such a focused attack of the satanic upon snaring men, snaring women, snaring the people of God with this diabolical demonic thing. Proverbs says that the one who is void of understanding enters at her door, and her door is the gates that go down into hell, and those that go in never return again. It is such a stronghold. Father, we pray in your mercy, moved by your Spirit right now. Father, we pray in your mercy, let Holy Ghost conviction fall in this place right now. Lord Jesus. Father, let your floodlight of heaven shine upon this place tonight. Father, may every person see that they naked before you with whom we have to do. Father, may everyone be able to see your love and your grace calling all men in this place to come and flee from the wrath that is to come and come and find refuge in you. Refuge in your love, refuge in your provision, refuge in your blood, refuge in your spirit, refuge in your anointing. Lord, may there not be a single person in this place tonight that is willing to go on in their own way, doing it their own way. Father, we pray tonight that every single person in this place will repent, will say yes to you, will bow before you, will bow before you. Lord, we know that you're the one who's not only come to save us and heal us and deliver us, but also to empower us. Lord, that your ability, God, is unequaled, is unmatchable. There's nothing that can overthrow you.
Jesus. Jesus. Brood over this place, God. Brood over this place, oh God. Brood over this place, oh God. Brood over this place, oh God. Holy Ghost, brood. Brood over this place, oh God. Brood over this place, oh God. Move over this place, oh God. Brood over this place, Father God. Holy Ghost, let your fire be among us. Lord Jesus, be as a refiner's fire and a fuller's salt here tonight, oh God. Brood, 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 God. Brood over this place, Lord. Brood over this place, Father. Brood over this place, oh God. Brood over this place, oh God. You begin to touch heaven. Those of you here tonight, you've given your life completely over to the Lord. And I just want you to know, you begin to touch heaven. And I'm going to tell you right now, the yoke will be broken off of your loved ones and off of your family members and off the people around you who have been taken out by them. They've been taken out. It's not good enough to just sit around and be unchanged and unmoved and even barely a tick above, lukewarm, and expect that somehow God's just going to come, you know, absent of you and apart from you and begin to move in the people's lives that are around you. No, Father's going to move through your life, through my life, through our life. And you're going to have to be willing to touch Him. You're going to have to be willing to break past all the stuff that's standing in the way. You're going to have to be able to break past all your stuff, all the things that are keeping you from being filled with His goodness and filled with His glory and filled with His divine power and strength and ability. Father's made a way. Father's given us the grace. Hallelujah. 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 Jesus is just saying, come on in. God, the Holy Ghost is saying, well, come on in. He ain't shut nobody out. You know, the Lord Jesus isn't saying you can't come in. He's saying, take the blood, come on in. He's saying, take the blood, take the blood, come in, take the blood, take the blood, come in, take the blood and come in. He's crying out to you. He's crying out to you. He's crying out to you. We don't come to Christ Jesus to get permission to be, continue on in sin and be right with God. He's not a pass that allows us to continue on in sin and be right with God. He's the door of escape from hell into heaven. People say, well, I don't believe that a loving God's going to send people to hell. People's decisions place them in hell every day. Hell in this life. Turmoil. Destruction. Broken relationships. Broken family. Loneliness. Hatred. And all the stuff that goes along with it. Jesus stands and says, come on in. I want to make you part of the family. Just come on in. I got life for you over here. Come on in. I got blessings. I got peace. I got goodness. I got a realm of life where there is no death in it. Come on in. He says, come on in. You just say, come on in.
Just saying, come on in. God's out. Come on in. Take the blood and come on in. Take the blood and come on in. Hallelujah. 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 You know, in some respects, it's like this. In some respects, it's like this. It's Passover night. In some respects, it's like this. Even though it was just a time and a day, and it seems it's been stretched out for 2,000 years right now, but still it's like this. We've come into God's means of salvation and His place of protection and His call of His covenant and placed the blood upon the mantle and upon the lintel. And we're there, shut out from the world, shut in a place, consecrated by God, with our lamps burning and our loins girt about with truth, ready to go, while we hear the screams of death outside. We know a remedy, a cure, and a provision for sin has been provided. A protection hid away in God so that death cannot enter. Hallelujah. Those of you who don't know, it's Passover week. Passover begins sundown Friday night. This is a unique Passover year. Usually Passover takes, this is the way the Hebrew calendar catches up. This is like a leap year. Usually it's a month earlier. But Jesus, my Passover lamb, I'm not going out. I'm not going to go out and run around the street tonight. And then go wander out there, see what's going on. See if there's something in Egypt that I still want. I'm shut away in the ark of safety. I've come on in. The door's closed. I've come in alone with Him and I've shut the door behind me. Hallelujah. I'm marked by God. I'm sealed with the Holy Ghost. People, you're going to have to see yourself there tomorrow when you're up against it, because Satan, listen, Satan knows. He knows the areas that you gave in, that your daddy gave in, that your granddaddy gave in, and back all the way to Adam. It's about time you get yourself right over into kinsmanship, huh? With Christ Jesus, hallelujah. And live in Him. So all He knows about you is Christ Jesus, and He recognizes that nothing worked on Jesus. None of His tricks worked on Jesus. Well, you start being tempted. You start being tempted to the devil. You just go, Father, look what He's trying to do. Father, strengthen me right now by Your glorious power and Your Spirit and enable. Father, I come to You for sanctuary right now. I thank You for Your authority over all unclean spirits to cast them out. And watch what I tell you right now. Temptation won't even have a chance. Won't even have a chance. Won't even have a chance. Won't even have it. Some of you people, we fought hell for you tonight. Are you going to come on in? Are you going to leave like you came? Are you going to come on in? Are you going to step into what God has provided for you? Are you going to walk out on God? Are you going to turn your back on God? Are you going to say, okay, Father, I'm going to take hold of that which You've given. I'm going to get serious with You. I'm going to get real with You, Father. So,
Saints of God, take hold of heaven, take hold of the glory, take hold of the anointing, and the world around you will be changed. Take hold of your privilege, of your access, and of your opportunity. Take hold of God, and watch what happens, watch what change takes place, watch what glory comes, watch what fire falls, watch what rivers flow. Jesus, 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 Jesus